So there are a bunch of common values for cosine and sine. And tangent. And you definitely knew these things or knew, learned these things back in pre-calculus, but it's definitely been a while. So here we go. This is the biggest unit circle I'm going to draw all year. So there's really nice fractions that come up on this unit circle. Fractions like 1/2. Okay, and this is clearly not a circle, but if I take this height of 1/2 and map it over, and I go straight over to that angle, okay, this angle is pi over 6. And a really nice thing happens if I take two of those angles. So I take 2/6, it's hard to say. I arrive at another angle called pi over 3. Right? Twice pi over 6 is pi over 3. You agree? And the interesting thing that happens is, instead of having a height of 1/2 now, the width of that triangle is now 1/2. Which makes sense. Because of what we just talked about last time and reflections about this line, y equals x. We just swap the x and the y coordinates when we reflect about that line. So if I take a pi over 6 angle, which has a y coordinate of 1/2, and I reflect it across this line, I arrive at a point which has x coordinate 1/2. Okay? All right, so we're filling in a table now. This is like the thing that I always encourage my pre-calc students to fill out like several times before they took quizzes and tests. Because it's just like doing flashcards. So I'm going to put down an angle of 0 first. We'll fill it in. I'll put down an angle of now pi over 6, and we'll fill in what we know. I'll put down a slightly larger angle, pi over 4, which we don't know yet about. And then we'll do pi over 3 next. And we can fill out something about that right now. And then we'll do pi over 2. So these nice little fractions. Halves, thirds, fourths, sixths. These are like the common angles that we learn about in pre-calc. So crash course real quick. Sine of pi over 6 is what? Sine of pi over 6 is?
1/2.
What is cosine of pi over 3? That's pi over 3. X and the y swap because we've reflected about that line. So cosine of pi over 3 is 1/2. Okay. Okay, let's fill in a few more angles that we know, and then I'm going to go to the Pythagorean theorem and work out some of these extra things that we don't yet know. When we have a 0-degree angle or a 0-radian angle, we're right here. What are the coordinates of the points? And so what are these? We've done this before. Sine is? Cosine is? Tangent is. What's it defined as? Sine of a cosine. What's? Okay, that should be like, just get it. You just got to write it down right away, right? Okay, pi over 2. This angle here was pi over 3. This one here is pi over 2. So we're up here. Think about those coordinates. We're on the unit circle. Okay, what's the sine of pi over 2?
1.
We're up at the top of the circle, radius 1. So we've moved up 1. How far over have we gone from the origin?
0.
Tangent is? Yeah, 1 over 0. Undefined. Or indeterminate is another way of saying it. Okay? Now what about these other ones? Is there a way we can figure out a second coordinate if we know the first coordinate? Or is there a way we can determine the first coordinate if we know the second coordinate. What do you all see here? Like, maybe I'll erase some of these lines. If I just drew this one in, what do you see here? Triangle, right triangle, that's important. This bottom length is?
Half.
1/2. What's the hypotenuse length?
1.
It's a unit circle, so this is the radius. There's a really classic math problem, like riddle, where somebody draws a circle, and then they do this, and then they do this, and they give you, they say this length is like 1, this length is like 6, like this diagonal, and then they say, okay, compute the radius of the circle. What's the radius of the circle? That's a rectangle inscribed in the top right. So what's the radius?
7.
Nice try. Common answer? No. More people answer that than you would guess, actually. What do you know about like diagonals and rectangles?
They're...
Say it. They're what? What's your intuition say there?
They're like both diagonals are like the same length.
They're the same length. So this other diagonal is also 6 in length? Okay, what's the radius of the circle?
6.
Okay. Good. Light bulb going. Yes, okay, good. Common riddle. Anyway. Only related because it has to do with radius. So here in this unit circle, the word unit means literally 1. The word unit is 1. We had a discussion right before class, some of us, about words and their appropriate usage in math class, right? And how you call things by appropriate names so that you know what they are without really knowing what they are. You just have to know what the word means and so you know what the thing is. Unit circle means this. Unit, radius. So base is 1/2. Radius is 1. How can we know this one? Pythagorean theorem. Says for any right triangle, you take side length A, square it. Take side length B, square it, and that gives you the length of the hypotenuse squared. Any right triangle. Which means I can determine this height, because I know this length and I know that. So on the unit circle, this translates directly to x coordinate, which is cosine of an angle, squared, plus sine, the y coordinate, of the angle squared equaling 1. 1/2 squared is 4. So depending on which way we're going here, let's start here. We'll try and figure out this. Cosine is 1/2, so 1/4 plus, let's get rid of this big word, who cares? It's y squared equals 1. What's 1 minus a 4th? 3/4. So this value squared is equal to 3/4. That's where we're at right now. So how do we find the value? It's either positive root 3 over 2. There's too many things flying around here. And then negative root 3 over 2. Both things work. That's the square root of 3 over 4, right? What physical meaning does this have? Well, this is the 3/4, root 3 over 2, length going up. This is the root 3 over 2, going down, creating an identical triangle, just reflected about the x-axis, which has the exact same angle, but now negative. Okay. So this Pythagorean theorem is extremely useful in finding all of these other values, which we do not yet know. In fact, you can find all of these three here with that. So Pi over 6, this is root 3 over 2. Pi over 3 is just the switching of these two. This one's root 3 over 2. Now, a tangent we can compute. It's sine over cosine, 1 half over root 3 over 2. Which is 1 over root 3. If you think that through just for a second, it's 1 divided by root 3. The 1 halves cancel. Which is the same as usually written root 3 over 3. It's usually how it's written. Pi over 3, we take sine divided by cosine. This is root 3 over 2 divided by 1 half. And this is just root 3. So I always told my pre-calc students, I've told them for years, I think it sometimes works, sometimes it doesn't, but I hope most of the time it works. You really only need to memorize a couple things. You need to memorize these coordinates for those angles. Okay, so that's kind of an obvious thing that people just know. They don't really have to work on that. But the other thing you have to memorize is these two values and the Pythagorean theorem. You don't really need to know much else. If you know sine of pi over 6 is 1 half, and you know the Pythagorean theorem, then you can compute this pretty quickly. And then you can compute this pretty quickly. If you know the cosine of pi over 3 is the same as the sine of pi over 6, then you can compute this and compute that as well. Okay? So this number attached with this number and this function, those are like critical things to memorize. Sine of pi over 6 is 1 half. Okay? All right. How do we compute pi over 4, sine, cosine, and tangent? So pi over 4 is exactly half of pi over 2, right? Yes. What does that mean about this height compared to this width? What do we know about them? They're the same. We go exactly halfway up this right angle to there. This height is exactly equal to that width. X equals y. So when you do the Pythagorean theorem, you know cosine is equal to sine. So this results in this similar formula. X squared plus y squared equals 1. Well, they're the same, so this is 2 times either of them. Solve for x. Again, the positive is for the triangle we literally just showed here. The negative is for this triangle going down negative root 1 over 2. But this value, square root of 1 over 2, is not usually written that way, right? It simplifies a little to this. 1 over root 2, it's usually written root 2 over 2. This is the exact same value. And because they're equal, tangent is equal to 1. So I don't expect that you'll have these like down right now, but for sure, this table should be something that's kind of like right there. In your top drawer of the tool cabinet. I don't know how many of you have a tool cabinet. Here, okay, maybe. This is in your top dresser drawer. That's like what you grab most often, okay? It's the first thing on the rack in the closet. You've got clothes hanging. Right next to the toothbrush. In your sock, so you don't forget it before you leave. Or a shoe, in your shoe. You put things in your shoes or socks. Okay, just me. This should be right there. All of these values. Okay? All right. I imagine when I was graphing sine and cosine, like the graphs, maybe you were concerned, maybe you couldn't remember these things, so you were not sure what I was graphing was actually what it should be. I know these, which is how I can draw the graph so quickly. Okay? That's how you can graph them so quickly as well. Okay. So, I went through the inverse for cosecant. So here it is for secant and for cotangent, just real quickly. So we have this equation which says the secant of some angle is some ratio, 1 over cosine. Cotangent of some angle is the ratio of some cosine over some sine of that angle, right? So if we restrict secant into this restricted part of the domain, and I stopped sort of along the way because we were getting things, we were slowing down because we didn't quite have values memorized. If we restrict our angle to be in there, that means we're only taking a specific branch of the secant graph, the secant function, and that is 1-to-1, and that is, that's 1-to-1, yep. Which means the inverse is also a function. So secant inverse is defined as the angle in that domain for secant with a ratio 1 over cosine equal to x. Okay, and I think we gave two examples. I did secant of 0, we found that was 1, and that means immediately, you know, 0 is in here, here's our x, that means immediately that secant inverse, when you plug in 1, returns exactly 0. I can ask other questions, like, what is secant of 2 pi, for example? Secant of 2 pi. Cosine of 0, everyone. Cosine of 0 is? 1, good. 2 pi is all the way around the circle, right? So what's cosine of 2 pi? Perfect. So what's the reciprocal of 1 over 1? Okay. So what's the secant inverse of 1? Trick question. Trick question. 0. Shoot. What happened? Well, is 2 pi in the domain of the secant when it's been restricted? No, it's not. Okay, this is why we restrict it. This is exactly why we do it. Because we can't have this business where like multiple things go to the same thing. Because if we try to go backwards, we get multiple things out. That's great when you're going to buy movie tickets and you get 2-for-1. Or when you're going to buy something, you know, shoes, you always get 2-for-1. But like in math, we don't want this. We want one definite answer coming back. So we restrict secant here. That means when we use the inverse function, everything gets packed back into here. Okay? Everything gets packed right here. We don't really care about the other angles. If we do, then we're not dealing with a function, which creates problems. Okay, sorry for that gotcha there, but maybe it's driving that point home just a little bit. So here we go. Cotangent of y. This is the easiest one. Just 0 to pi. So on the unit circle, we're talking about angles that are in this upper half plane. Okay. That's like the easiest one to sort of think about. And I'm not going to do any examples. It's just ratios of sines and cosines. And we're running out of time. questions before moving on about these? Okay, all right. Here we go. So that's it for 1.5. And we are now moving on to section 2.1. I need to apologize right away because the words we're going to be using today are very similar to the words we've been using just a minute ago. We're going to use this word tangent again, but it's not the same tangent. Sorry. And even worse, it gets worse. We're going to be using this word secants, or secant, but it's not the trig secant. So this is going to be maybe a little confusing, but I will say that the way the words are used in this section are the like typical usages. You know, you Google the definition of a word, and it gives you all the different definitions. These are usually, like, these are the ones that are listed first, okay? So I used a word tangent when I was helping pre and before class here. I said, this is tangent to what we're doing, or maybe it was someone else, but if I said, hey, I'm gonna go off on a tangent here for a second, what does that mean? The phrase, what does it mean? I'm gonna break off from what I'm doing right now and do something maybe unrelated. Okay, that's the meaning. Okay? So there's this problem in mathematics of finding the slope of something that is tangent to a given curve. So I think the nicest non-function that we have that we're most familiar with is a circle. Got a lot of symmetry to it. And I can easily draw straight lines that are tangent to it. So imagine you're living on this circle. That's you. And you start walking around it. Okay, you mosey over to the store, come on back home, and I don't know, go somewhere else, go to a friend, then come back. You travel along the edge of this circle, and your velocity is always tangent to the circle. So if you're moving this way, this arrow can represent literally the direction that you're stepping. If you were to turn around and go exactly the opposite way around that circle, this would represent the other direction you could go. Right? Now, immediately upon taking your first step, you fall a little bit back down onto the circle. So you stop traveling in a straight line. But for that split second, before you've fallen, you are in fact traveling in the straight line out, tangent to the circle. Okay? So the line that I've drawn right now is a tangent line. At this point, which I'll call x0. Can you tell me like a general characteristic of its slope? What's its slope? It's constant. Say it louder.
Constant.
It's not, whoa, yes, it is constant. The slope is constant. Yes, 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 yes. Is it bigger than zero, less than zero? Zero?
Less than zero.
It's a negative slope, right? Okay. What about this point? Here's x1. You're traveling along the circle, so you either go this way or you go this way. Slope is positive at this point. How about right here, x3? If you want to go this way, you've got to go like that. If you want to go this way, you've got to go that way. And the slope is
zero.
Okay. These are all tangent lines to the circle at various points. And even though you've only given me, or even though I've only given you one point for each line, you've all told me the exact right answers about their slopes. Right? If I asked you sort of a, not a parallel, but not a tangent question, but a parallel question, What is the slope at A point on the circle? Maybe you all would throw up your hands and say, I can't do it. Why can't you do it with just one point?
You need 2 points to determine the line.
You need 2 points to determine the line. Like, historically, how have you calculated slope? Y2 minus Y1, two y values, divided by X2 minus X1, two x values. You need 2 points. But if I said, hey, here's 1 point on the circle, compute the slope of the circle there. Intuitively, you know it's a positive number. And it's constant. Intuitively. But how do you go about doing that? That's the tangent problem. I wonder if you have any intuition as to how to solve that tangent problem. Yeah?
Is it like clockwise? Here up the circle, like... No.
I don't know what you mean. You said a few words.
Like,
clockwise around the circle?
Yeah, so like if you start at the top, then it's going to be like 0. But then like as you go down, the handle's on the top, as you go down,
mm-hmm.
it goes down.
Oh, yes, I see what you're saying. Mm-hmm. You're talking about like 0, undefined, 0, undefined, positive, negative. Negative, positive. You're talking about those general characteristics?
Yeah. I mean,
what if I wanted to know exactly the slope? Like, you know, I draw a line equation, and I want to know exactly the slope. What is it? 3, right? Literally the number 3. What's literally the slope at this point? How might you figure that number out?
Is that the slope of the line that's perpendicular to the radius?
Perfect. Perfect. So on a circle, you've got geometric rules. This is a radius. Maybe we can construct a line that is perpendicular to that radius, and it goes through that point, and then we can compute the slope of this line by taking another point, a second point, along with the first. Brilliant. That's one way to do it with a circle. Yeah? That's why the circle is such a great introductory example. Oh man, that's great. Okay, what about not a circle? So a random curve. I want to know the slope of the curve at that point. You could already tell me it's positive. It's not 0. It's not negative. It's definitely coming up, right? Okay, so you've got to use what you know. How do we compute slope? It's y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1, right? You've got 1 point, so what do you need? You need a second point. Will any point work? Sure. If I said, here's your second point, compute the slope, you could do this. And what you'll be doing is computing the slope of that line. We call this the average slope. Average slope between 2 points. This line is called the secant line. Literally, this word, secant, means second. Why? Because we've taken a second point to create that line. We were given one, and we create a second point to create the secant line, that which comes from the second. Secant line. Is that secant line slope equal to the tangent line slope? No. Can we get something that's closer? Yes, what would you do? Oh, what? Perpendicular to what? We don't have a radius anymore. That's a good idea. Good idea. How can we get some slope that's closer to the secant line, or closer to the tangent line's slope? I think we would all agree the tangent maybe has something like, maybe that's not quite right. I should be right in front to draw it. We would all agree that's like the tangent line, right? More or less. How can we get a better approximation for it? Now the hands are going up, yeah. Make a right triangle. Simpler than that. That's going to involve some complicated geometry. Hassan.
We need to approach the slope.
We need to, sorry, say what?
Approach the slope.
Oh, we need to move this point closer.
Yes.
Perfect. This graph just suggests right away that if we fix this point, and we let this point sort of travel closer and closer, this graph definitely suggests that we'll approach a secant line with slope approximately equal to the tangent line slope, right? You see that? Perfect. Okay, let's do it. I'll give you a function now, and we're going to apply that rule, that idea. Yeah, we got time. So here's the general idea. We want to say, find the slope of y equals x squared. What is this? This is a, what kind of curve is this? Not an exponential. Exponential is base, it's a constant number to a variable power. So this is a generic power function, not exponential. It is also a well-known polynomial, right? Right? Okay. Does this parabola, this quadratic, go through this point? Yeah? Does it? How do you check if a given function has a graph that goes through a given point? You just plug in both values. You plug in one for x, and you better get out this. So does it go through this point? Yes, because 1 equals 1. Very good. So now we're going to apply this point, or this rule. We're going to evaluate our function at that point. So, we know what that is. It's right here, in the point. 1, 1. And then we're going to take the slope. So y1 and, or y2 and x1 or x2, whichever number we want. And we're going to find the evaluation of our function at a different point. So we plug in x, and we are going to get out x squared. And we want to approach this number for x. So let me graph this out for you to give you the geometric picture of it. Here's x squared. Here's the point, 1, 1. Okay. We're going to pick another point, x, either smaller than 1 or bigger than 1. It doesn't matter to me. Do you mind which one you use? Do you care? Don't really care. Great. All right. You're going to pick up another point, x. You're going to get the output of that. And you're going to find the slope of this. how do we make this secant line get closer and closer and closer to the tangent while we make this x value get closer and closer and closer to 1? Okay? So this is our function that tells us the average slope of that secant line. Can you simplify this at all?
You do x plus 1, x minus 1.
Beautiful. You just took your first derivative. Well done. When we plug in 1 to this function, which we can do, we get 2, right? Okay, you can see my spreadsheet here. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm just gonna create a table of values, okay? I'm gonna start off at, let's go with like 1.5, 1.1, 1.001, 1.0001, 1.0000001, 1. Lots more ones or zeros, and it corrects it to that. Okay, now what I'm going to do is, because this is my table of x's, what I'm going to do is I'm going to compute the average slope. Okay, just using the same function that we had before. Okay, so the average slope was equal to this value squared minus 1 divided by this value minus 1. 2.5 is what the original secant line slope was. And the closer x gets to 1, the closer this actually gets to 2. Okay, so numerically, this is exactly how you compute the slope of the tangent line. You approximate it by using secant lines, which gets closer and closer and closer to that tangent line. Okay. This function is really nice because you can actually simplify this average slope to find the exact function. Okay. Right. So questions on what we did there, how we found that slope? No? Okay, that's essentially half of 2.1. The second half recasts this exact problem in terms of a more physical, real-world example that we have, that of velocity. And so, real briefly, as I'm ending this class, maybe we'll just pick it up next week. So for the homework that's due next week, Thursday, there's not very many questions, I think, on some of the assignments. And they have you doing things similar to this, where you're computing average slope. To compute average slope, you just use the typical slope function, okay? And now you know if you're computing the slope of a secant, it's just the slope of those secant lines that have been drawn. And I would encourage you to use a spreadsheet, okay? Using a calculator is okay, but you're going to be writing a lot of tables of values by hand. A spreadsheet can automatically fill equations for you. So like what you saw, I typed what to do once, and then I filled it. If you don't know how to do that, go learn how to do it. And then use Google Sheets or Excel or numbers to do the tables for you. Okay? Now you can't do that on quizzes and tests, but I won't ask you to do this on quizzes and tests. Okay? Alright, so that's it. Have a great weekend. I'll see you all next time.